Our services this morning, Brother Kathy Metter will lead our singing, opening prayer by Aidney Rees. Brother Mitchell will present the sermon. Herschel McDonald will have communion service and a closing prayer by Sam McDonald. Let's go to our Heavenly Father in prayer. Gracious Heavenly Father, we're thankful for this Lord's Day, thankful for the ability for us to gather as your people. We pray that as we conduct ourselves this morning in worship to you, that everything that we do and say will be in accordance with your will. We always desire that the things we do are pleasing to you, bring honor and glory to your name. Help us, Father, to reach out to those round about us that are sick. Help us to do those things that would be needful on their behalf. Be with us through the remainder of this service. In Christ's name, amen.
Number 871. 871.
In his time, he makes beautiful. In his time, Lord, please show me every day, as you teach me in your way, that you do just what you say in your time, in your time, in your time. You make all things beautiful in your time. Lord, my love to you I bring. May each song I have to sing be to you a lovely thing in your time, in your time, in his time. He makes all things beautiful in his time. Lord, please show me every day, as you teach me in your way, that you do just what you say in your time, in your time, in your time. You make all things beautiful in your time. Lord, my life to you I bring. May each song I have to sing be to you a lovely thing in your time.
I'd ask you to pray with me, please, if you would, to go to our Heavenly Father in prayer. Dear God, we come before you this morning thanking you for our life and for the health that we get to enjoy, that we're able to come out and worship you. And I pray that you'll forgive us of our sins. Help us, dear Heavenly Father, to be mindful of the things that are sin in our life and try to avoid them. And we pray that our sins will be forgiven as we ask for forgiveness, because you've told us that you would forgive our sins. That would help us that we might come before you with a clean and honest heart. We recognize, dear God, that this coronavirus is causing a lot of problems in our nation and throughout the world, and it's even causing us difficulties in our local congregations and in your church throughout the world, that we're not able to meet and worship as we have in the past. And we're just so thankful that we're able to get together at this time and still worship you. We're thankful that you protect us, and we're so thankful that you're in charge of this universe, and you know what is best for the world, and we feel that you will do the things that's necessary to correct the situation, that we will soon be back to normal, and we know that will happen if it will be your will. We pray, dear God, that you would be with those that are not able to be with us today, because there are many on our sick list, and We're especially mindful of those that have been mentioned, Brother Kenneth Yarber and Brother David Vasquez, and we're thankful that Brother Mike has made progress, that he's able to be at home. We have others that have been mentioned that we also pray that you'll be with them and with many of our family and loved ones that are suffering from illnesses, and we ask that your blessings be with them, and we ask that your will be done in all things, and help us to always appreciate and understand that we don't know what's best for ourselves and for others, but you do. And we pray that you'll always help us to accept your will and realize that you know best. We're thankful, dear God, for our nation and for the freedoms that we get to enjoy. And we pray for the men and women throughout the world that are serving our nation in whatever capacity, that you would protect and watch over them and help them, that they might be successful, that this nation will continue to always be free. We pray, dear God, that you would be with our local congregation here, that you'll be with our elders, that you'll continue to give them the wisdom as they have the oversight and make the decisions for the direction which this congregation would have to go. We pray for the deacons that work under them so diligently, that have so many works that they do that we're not aware of and can't even appreciate, but we do love them and appreciate the work that they do. We pray for their continued strength. We pray for their family members, their loved ones, their wives, and their children that have to make sacrifices to give up the time that their loved ones are away serving you and doing work in your kingdom. We pray, dear God, also for the various teachers of the Bible classes and for the sacrifices that they make when they give up their time to study, prepare lessons that they might teach our loved ones here, and even those that teach the adult classes, that we might learn, and help us all, dear God, to study your word and go about looking to the things that will teach us how to be better Christians and be stronger soldiers in your kingdom and serve you in a better capacity than we have in the past. We pray that you would be with Brother Lyndall Mitchell and give him the ready recollection of the things that he studied that he wants to say to us today. Help us that we might have an open mind, and we might study with him your word, that all of us might be stronger and be better servants. We're thankful for his wife, Pamela, and for the service that they've given to you and for this congregation. We're thankful for their dedication and their willingness to continue to serve. We pray, dear God, that you would be with each and every one of us, that as we're here this morning, that we might remove from our minds and our hearts the thoughts and the cares of the things of this world, that for the next few minutes that we can honestly look at the scriptures that are being presented, that we can find things in our scripture always that will help us and teach us to be better servants to you. We realize, dear God, that there are so many in this congregation that are elderly, that are suffering to be here and have illnesses and pains and more than some of us can even realize, but we're so thankful for their dedication and for their desire to serve you, that they're willing to come out because they're an inspiration to the rest of us, that we see those that struggle with their health but still have a desire to be here and serve you. We're so thankful for that. And we pray, dear God, that you would be with each of us, that we might do our best to serve you, that we can work for you in your kingdom to the best of our ability. And when the time comes, it will come to all of us, that we have to face the judgment day and we have to cross over those chilly waters of death and stand before you. Our hope and desire is that we will have served you in such a way that you'll be able to tell you to us, well done, thy good and faithful servant, enter into the kingdom of rest. This is our prayer in your Son and our Savior's dear name. Amen.
Number 4444.
Earthly wealth and fame may never come to me, and a path
Please turn to number 138. 138.
Tempted and tried, we're oft made to wonder why it should be thus all the day long, while there are others living in spite of us, never molested, though in the wrong.
Song of encouragement will be number 520. 520.
It's good to see each of you this morning, and welcome to the service. I hope and pray that everything that we say and that we do this morning will be beneficial to you, and that you'll recognize strengthening from the power of God's Word. Turn with me now, if you would, to Zephaniah. That's in the Old Testament. It's in the Minor Prophets. It'll be toward the back of the Old Testament. When you get to Zephaniah, go to chapter 1. And let's look together at what the prophet is led of the Lord to say. He said, "It will come about at that time that I will search Jerusalem with lamps, and I will punish the men who are stagnant in spirit, who say in their hearts, 'The Lord will not do good or evil.' Moreover, their wealth will become plunder, their houses desolate. Yes, they will build houses, but not inhabit them, and plant vineyards, but not drink their wine." This prophecy was directed at the city of Jerusalem and the surrounding area. The citizens had grown stagnant in spirit. He describes it in the New American Standard Version. The New King James Bible says settled in complacency. And with everybody restricted to home, and I suppose that's a hardship, but except when you back up and think about the kind of homes that most North Americans have. Air conditioned. I don't think you could stay in Texas without that. It'd be difficult for me anyway. Air conditioned homes. Entertainment centers that are second to none anywhere in the world. You know, just a very nice place to be. And so before we allow ourselves to feel too badly for the difficulties that we're facing, and I'm certainly not minimizing those, I want us to think together about the threat that complacency is to us today as it was to the people in Zephaniah's time. Complacency will keep us focused on the here and now and distract us, if we're not very careful, from the real goal, which is to leave this world better than we found it, and to leave this world prepared to meet God. Complacency will keep people from improving their service to the Lord, and it will prevent them from forsaking their sins. Complacency prevents people from becoming pleasing to God, and it sets people up for punishment. It did in Zephaniah's time. And, of course, the implication of that is it will in our generation as well. And so I want us to consider how these people were stagnant in spirit, not in a way that we would feel superior and look down upon them, but that we learn the lessons that they had to learn in a very hard way, and that we determine we're not going to let that happen to us, not about that. And we see, first of all, that excessive comfort led to stagnation of spirit in Zephaniah's time. It's not that it's better to be without the necessities of life, but when we have abundance, there is the tendency to assume those things will always be present, to begin to feel like we're entitled to have those things as a part of our lives, and to just presume on the Lord who provides it all. So these folks are now facing God's punishment because they've become too comfortable. These are too easy for them, and they have basically forgotten about who provided it. The text makes explicit reference to the wealth and the houses and the vineyards, the crops, moneymakers. Are they wrong in and of themselves? Of course not. Certainly not. But they do have the capacity, the ability to distract people. And so in their case, that became their focus. They were consumed with the here and now. And that led them away from their service to the Lord. And this is in spite of the fact that they had for centuries had with them the warning that Moses had written in his restatement of the law in Deuteronomy chapter 6. He'd warned them about this very thing, beginning at verse 10. He said, "Then it shall come about when the Lord your God brings you into the land which he swore to your fathers, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, to give you, great and splendid cities which you did not build, and houses full of all good things which you did not fill, and hewn cisterns which you did not dig, vineyards and olive trees which you did not plant. And you eat and are satisfied. Then watch yourself. Why is that, Moses? That you do not forget the Lord who brought you from the land of Egypt out of the house of slavery. It's not wrong. He gave them these things to enjoy. They're not evil. They're neutral, but you have to be careful with that. It is sad because the comfort that we enjoy in this life, as the comfort they enjoy, that's God's gift to us. He would prefer for us to enjoy it within proper perspective, of course. Ecclesiastes chapter 5, beginning at verse 18. The wise man wrote, "Here is what I've seen to be good and fitting, to eat, to drink, and enjoy oneself and all of one's labor in which he toils under the sun during the few years of his life which God has given him. For his reward and rejoice in his labor, this is the gift of God." So that's the Lord's intention. And that's why he gives it in such abundance. In James chapter 1 and verse 17, James was inspired to write, "Every good thing given and every perfect gift is from above, coming down from the Father of lights, with whom there is no variation or shadow of turning." You likely are familiar when I will give the illustration of our little garden, but I never let myself forget that God's the one that gives the increase. All in the world I do is till the soil a little bit and put the seeds in the ground, and he does the rest. It's his sunshine, his rain, his provision of the spark of life within those seeds. Physical comfort is a good thing, but it does indeed have a way of making spiritual needs seem not so urgent. You know, we have this to do and that party to attend and this gathering, and we can become self-focused and the things we're doing are good in and of themselves, but they're not the main thing. You get mission creep and get focused on the things that are peripheral and forget about what the Lord values most. That attitude befell the rich man in the Lord's parable in Luke chapter 12. You remember this man came to him and he wanted to know what else he needed to do. And he'd been told was keep the law. He said, I've done that. What else? So the Lord told him. He said, you go sell what you have and give it to the poor. He didn't want to do that. We'll come back to him. But we see that kind of thing. There was also in the one in Luke 12 where the man concludes, he's done everything. He's been successful, wildly successful. And rather than focus himself on the cause of the Lord and use those resources that have been given into his hand in a productive way, he decides, "So you have much good laid up for many years to come. Take your ease, eat, drink, and be merry." Luke 12, 19. He doesn't acknowledge the Lord. He doesn't acknowledge any responsibility. Ignoring one's spiritual needs and responsibilities, even for a short time, is a dangerous thing. It is a foolhardy thing. You look at verse 20 of Luke 12. What did God say to that man? He said, "You fool, this very night your soul is required of you. And now, who will own what you have prepared?" Well, it was something, you know, undoubtedly probably for the relatives to fight over, but he's left it all behind like we all do. Acquisition of wealth, possession of wealth and status, that's not wrong, but it must never be given a greater priority than the cause of our Lord. We're, as far as I know, the only society in the history of the world that has assumed that everybody is entitled to about 30, 35 years in ease and comfort that we call retirement. There are a lot of retired people here today. Now, you know, one makes a choice whether how they use their time and their resources. and whether or not they'll dedicate it to the cause of the Lord. But these individuals were not. We can't ever allow anything to take priority over their dedication we have to the cause. In Matthew chapter 6 in verse 24, he says, "No one can serve two masters, for they hate the one and love the other, or else he will despise the one and be devoted to the other." But he said, you cannot serve God and wealth. Indeed. And if necessary, the Lord calls upon us to be willing to sacrifice anything and everything, to relinquish whatever it is in order to pursue his will. And those who are in some ways fortunate enough to become wealthy find it hard to do that sometimes. We know that because of what Matthew 19:21 says. I couldn't know it in any other way because I'm not wealthy and never expect to be. But these people were, and Jesus said to this man, if you wish to be complete, go and sell your possessions. So he'd read his heart. He didn't tell anybody else that, but he told this man that when he wanted to know what to do. You go and sell your possessions and give to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven, and come and follow me. But when the young man heard this statement, he went away grieving, for he was one who owned much property. And Jesus said to his disciples, truly I say to you, it is hard for a rich man to enter the kingdom of heaven. And again I say to you, it is easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for a rich man to enter the kingdom of God. Twice in rapid succession, he says essentially the same thing, changes the illustration a little bit. He says it's hard for a man rich in this world's goods to make it to heaven. And why is that? Well, because it is imperative that we understand the dangers of wealth. That's why he gives that illustration twice, for emphasis' sake. It's imperative that we understand the perils of material wealth that they present to us. We're admonished not to fix our hope on the uncertainty of riches, but rather on God. When I began to be able to contribute to a little retirement program, the man that managed that told me very honestly and very candidly on the front end, he said, Brother Mitchell, I cannot tell you what the stock market will or won't do. I'm just going to get that right out in the open. I can't do that. And neither can anybody else. I can tell you what it does over time. And here's, you know, the goal that we're going to establish. But we may or may not be successful. He was very much up front. And that's one reason I went with him. But we're admonished, don't fix your hope on those things. Why? Because they're fleeting. In 1 Timothy chapter 6 and verse 17, he said, instruct those who are rich in this present world not to be conceited or to fix their hope on the uncertainty of riches, but on God who richly supplies us with all things to enjoy. I had an opportunity as a very young man to offer to study the gospel with a much older man who had lost money in the Great Depression in the 1920s. He'd made and lost two or three large fortunes. But he talked about that in 1929 and said he went to bed with a direct line of credit with the banks of $375,000. Now, that's 1929. And woke up the next morning and said couldn't buy a cup of coffee. He knew the truth of what God said, that these things are something that you don't want to depend on that. You don't want to count on God. Becoming too comfortable in our spiritual lives continues to be a serious threat to us, particularly in the wealthiest country that's ever existed. And so it is incumbent upon each Christian to continue to grow, to continue to serve, to continue to maintain focus on the things that God's focused on. In 2 Peter 3 and verse 18, Peter writes, but grow in grace and knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. To him be glory, both now and to the day of eternity. We are prohibited from just maintaining the status quo. We're prohibited in very clear terms of just staying as we are, the same level of maturity. Some of you know already where we'll go. Hebrews chapter 5, the Hebrews writer speaking to the brethren, and in he's pretty stern with them. Why is that? Well, he says, though by this time you ought to be teachers. Well, they're not teachers. Not only are they not teachers, he says, you have need again for someone to teach you the elementary principles of the oracles of God And you have come to need milk and not solid food, for everyone who partakes only of milk is not accustomed to the word of righteousness, for he is an infant. But solid food is for the mature, who because of practice have their senses trained to discern good and evil. And so it's a strong admonition. It's not a complimentary thing that he observes about them. And he's concerned. Notice how Paul spoke of the hope of resurrection in contrast to that. In Philippians chapter 3, verses 13 and 14, we see his posture, his attitude. He said, "Brethren, I do not regard myself to as having laid hold of it yet. But one thing I do, forgetting what lies behind and reaching forward to what lies ahead, I press on toward the goal for the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus." He was not static, nor was he stagnant. He was continuing to grow in knowledge, grow in fervor. He says in the Corinthian correspondence that we're taking every thought captive. That is a powerful idea, to take every thought captive to our Lord. Paul was determined that he was not going to allow his past to hamper his progress toward the heavenly kingdom. And on this point, you might immediately think of sins within your own life. Many times in dealing with prisoners out here at the Polunsky unit, I've had some of them express doubts, not about God, but about whether or not they themselves are redeemable. They're very candid, very honestly say, "You know, Brother Mitchell, I believe in God, but I've been a bad man. I don't know if he could forgive me." But he can. Said he would. In 1 Timothy 1, beginning at verse 12, Paul wrote, "I thank Christ Jesus our Lord, who has strengthened me because he considered me faithful, putting me into service. Even though I was formerly a blasphemer and a persecutor and a violent aggressor, yet I was shown mercy because I acted ignorantly in unbelief, and the grace of our Lord was more than abundant with faith and life which were found in Christ Jesus. It is a trustworthy statement, deserving of all acceptance, that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners, of whom I am foremost of all. Yet for this reason I found mercy, so that in me as the foremost, Jesus Christ might demonstrate his perfect patience as an example for those who would believe in him for eternal life." You hadn't been any rougher than Paul. Nobody in his house has. And God saved him. But we must not allow our past to keep us from pursuing the goal. And we must not allow accomplishments and victories to keep us from pressing on. You know, sometimes people can become complacent because of the victories they've won. They've got some trophies in the cabinet, got some medals hanging on the wall and two or three certificates, you know. And then we can become complacent, and following complacency is stagnance or stagnation. Our faithfulness is not to be just until we've scored some victory, but our faithfulness is, John wrote, until death in Revelation 2 in verse 10. Distracted discipleship equals or leads to diminished service. We see that in the text. The people in Zephaniah's prophecy still acknowledge God to some degree. They addressed him as the Lord. And while they declared the Lord will not do good or evil, their statement implies they believe that he exists. But now that statement, "he will not do good or evil," translated into East Texas, filtered through a Mississippi accent, it would be, "he ain't going to do nothing." That's what they conclude. "He ain't going to do nothing no how." That's a very foolish decision to come to posture to occupy, but they did. And sadly, judgment will reveal many who believe in God's existence, and some that even serve him according to their own dictates and directives. In Matthew 7, 22 and 23, he said, many will say to me in that day, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in thy name, and in thy name cast out demons, and in thy name done many wonderful works? And then will I declare them, I never knew you, depart from me, you who practice lawlessness. So they hadn't forgotten God completely, but they weren't observing, they weren't being careful, they weren't paying attention, and it led to diminished service. If it's not obedient, if it's not according to the will of God, it's not acceptable. One of the problems that they had in Jerusalem is that they no longer gave God credit for their blessings. Kind of like one of these feral hogs under a pecan tree. If you're up on the family ranch, they eat the pecans up before you can get a chance to get to them. The hog never looks up to see where the pecans come from. He just gets them. He's that way. In truth, the Lord always does good. And James tells us in James 1, verse 17, every good thing and every perfect gift is from above, coming down from the Father of lights, with whom there is no variation nor shifting shadow. In his providence, he gives everybody the rains from heaven. He gives everybody the fruitful seasons. And without his providence, human existence on this planet would be utterly impossible. I read an article or part of an article where they think they're about to unlock some things on quantum mechanics. That's a little complex to my liking, but I wish them well, and I hope they understand better. But because of what's revealed in Scripture, I can tell them, and you can too, what it's all dependent on. Colossians 1, 16 and 17 says, for by him all things created, both in the heavens and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions or rulers or authorities, all things have been created through him and for him. He is before all things, and listen, and in him all things hold together. Now that includes quarks and nuons and whatever other subatomic particles they might discover out there in the future, all of it. It all subsists in him. And when one no longer acknowledges God as the source of his blessings, then he's not going to find it within himself to be thankful for those blessings. 1 Thessalonians 5 and verse 18 said, in everything give thanks, for this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus. I think of some of the great business titans today that are fabulously wealthy people, whether you like them or don't like them. Bill Gates, multi-billionaire. Does anybody think he was necessarily the best computer programmer in the world? Or you think maybe he was at the right place and fell into some fortuitous circumstances? A man named Jeff Bezos got the idea of Amazon. Does anybody think that he's just all that much smarter than everybody else who's in the shipping and business, warehousing and selling items? Or do you think maybe he just inherited some good circumstances or was blessed? When a guy does it, and I don't know what those men do, I don't know them, but when anybody, whether he's a business titan or not, fails to recognize where his blessings come from, then he's going to not be thankful. And without a grateful heart, one cannot please the Lord. In Hebrews 12 and verse 28, he says, therefore, since we receive a kingdom which cannot be shaken, let us show gratitude by which we may offer to God an acceptable service with reverence and awe. For our God is a consuming fire. Every good gift and every perfect gift comes down from above. Secondly, those who lose the fear of the Lord, those who become stagnant lose their fear of the Lord and of the judgment, just like these Jews did. They cease to remember and acknowledge who gave them their blessings, And not only that, there, you know, the Lord will not do evil. Again, he ain't going to do nothing. Zephaniah chapter 1, 12 and 13. Throughout the biblical record, however, we see that God is willing to punish the rebellious, that he will deal with that without hesitation, though he is patient. In 1 Corinthians chapter 10, beginning at verse 6, the text says, "Now these things happened as examples for us, so that we would not crave evil things as they also crave. Do not be idolaters as some of them were, as it is written, the people sat down to eat and drink and they stood up to play. Nor let us act immorally as some of them did, and 23,000 fell in one day. Nor let us try the Lord as some of them did and were destroyed by the serpents. Nor grumble as some of them did and were destroyed by the destroyer. Now these things happened to them as an example." So we're supposed to get a lesson from that. "And they were written for our instruction, upon whom the end of the ages has come." These people had lost the fear of the Lord, and they'd lost the fear of his judgment. Let's not imitate that. These things that have happened in the past are at least partly, and maybe even primarily, there for our example. And that's why it's recorded. Not so that we might feel superior to those folks and say, "Man, how can anybody make those mistakes just like we make them?" And he says, "So be instructed." Many mock today as they did then, say, "Well, you know, where is the coming of the Lord? Where is the fulfillment of the promise? I don't see him. Do you see him?" I know a guy say that to me one time. He thought that was funny. 2 Peter chapter 3 and verse 3, we must not think that the passage of time means anything to God. In 2 Peter 3 and verse 8, he says, "Do not let this one fact escape your notice, that with the Lord, one day is like 1,000 years, and 1,000 years like one day." And so we want to be very careful. There may be many centuries yet to come. I don't know, and you don't know. My personal belief is there is not. But I don't know that. That's just my opinion. And it's worth about what it costs. But I know this, that he will come. In 2 Peter 3, verses 9 and 10, Peter wrote, "The Lord is not slow about his promise, as some count slowness, but is patient toward you, not wishing that any would perish, but that all would come to repentance. But the day of the Lord will come like a thief, in which the heavens will pass away with a roar, and the elements will be destroyed with intense heat, and the earth and its works will be burned up. When that great day comes, each person, each one of us, will be called upon to give an accounting." In 2 Corinthians 5 and verse 10, Paul wrote, "For we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, that everyone may receive the things done in his body, according to that he hath done, whether it be good or evil." The fate of those who became stagnant is given to us. If you become that and stay that way, it's a bad ending. Those who grow complacent and comfortable will be disappointed. We learned that. Material things that people put their trust in, which they allow to distract them from their service to God, those things don't last. Matthew chapter 6, verses 19 through 21 said, "Do not store up for yourselves treasures on earth, where moth and rust doth destroy, and where thieves break in and steal. But store up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where neither moth nor rust destroys, and where thieves do not break in or steal. For where your treasure is, there will your heart be also." I think of the illustration that is powerful to me is the price now of a new automobile. And you look at that price, that's a big expenditure of treasure. And if you're lucky, you'll get 10 years service out of it. And I'm not telling you not to get a new car or to feel bad if you have one. But I'm saying recognize that it won't last any more than any other earthly thing, and keep it in proper perspective. Those things are tools, but they're not the ultimate focus, or should not be, of our life. Even in this life, see, things are unfleeting and uncertain. In 1 Timothy 6 and verse 17, Paul wrote, "Instruct those who are rich in this present world not to be conceited or to fix their hope on the uncertainty of riches, but on God, who richly supplies us with all things to enjoy." Nothing in this life compares to the reward of following the Lord. Moses recognized that as a young man. And you'll remember that he made the choice in Hebrews 11, it's written about, that he made the choice to be numbered among God's persecuted people rather than stay in the Pharaoh's house as the adopted son of the Pharaoh's daughter, because he was looking to the reward. He made a good choice. And there's no indication he ever regretted that choice. Those who are complacent will be disappointed, and they'll also be punished. And God warns us so that we won't be. Salvation requires continuing diligence. In Hebrews 4 and verse 11, he says, "Therefore, let us be diligent to enter that rest so that no one will fall through following the same example of disobedience." You know, the Bible does not teach once saved, always saved, which is so popular among the denominational churches. It'd be preached all over this town this morning. But 1 Corinthians 9 and verse 27 has the Apostle Paul saying, "But I discipline my body and make it my slave so that after I have preached to others, I myself will not be disqualified." Unless we continue growing, we'll be cut off. But we have the opportunities before us. Even in this diminished capacity, we've been given an opportunity to have a season of fervent prayer and intense study. So the question is, what are you doing with the opportunity? What am I doing with that opportunity? Because he's given that to us. To avoid stagnation and its consequences, we've got to accept personal responsibility. It's not your responsibility to keep me from stagnating, and it's not mine to keep you from doing that. We have to accept personal responsibility. In Philippians 2 and verse 12, he says, "So then, my beloved, just as you have always obeyed, not as in my presence only, but now much more in my absence, work out your own salvation with fear and trembling." Personal responsibility is necessary. Because, for one, we are all created in the image of God. Genesis chapter 1 tells us that, verses 26 and 27, that he said, "Let us make man in our own image." And it goes on to say that in the image of God that he made man, male and female, he made them. There was no ambiguity. And so that's who we are. And being children of God, he expects us to act like it. Requires it, in fact. And personal responsibility is essential because Jesus died on the cross to redeem us from the rebellious state that our forefathers entered, and we followed them right on into it. And Jesus died to redeem us. In 2 Corinthians 5, 14 and 15, Paul writes, "For the love of Christ controls us, having concluded this, that one died for all, therefore all died. And he died for all so that they might live no longer for themselves, but for him who died and rose again on their behalf." Accepting responsibility is imperative because judgment looms. And if time stands, we're going to lose a lot more citizens than we've already lost to this plague that's stalking the world. Most people, thank God, recover, but many do not. And so we need to be circumspect. And we need to be very careful. We need to accept responsibility for our own spiritual growth and development, and to band with our brethren in every capacity that we can. Accepting responsibility is essential because everyone is going to receive his own reward, not somebody else's. You know, you don't be like a friend. I had a constable friend one time, and I was trying to talk to him about his soul, and I asked him, "Are you a Christian?" He said, "I believe in God, but no, not really. But my wife is." Well, you know, my friend, you're not going to inherit your wife's reward. 2 Timothy 4:7 and 8, Paul said, I have fought a good fight. I have finished the course. I have kept the faith. Henceforth, there is laid up for me a crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, shall give me on that day, and not to me only, but unto all them also that love his appearing. So everybody will reap their own reward or not. God told the people in Zephaniah's time, in chapter 1 of Zephaniah and verse 12, that I will search Jerusalem with a lamp. What's he saying? He's saying that there's not going to be any hiding. There's no going to be nowhere to run. I'm going to search the place out. And I'm going to expose, deal with what's amiss and reward that which is good. We must conform our lives, continue to do that, purposely to His will, even to the thoughts and the intentions of our hearts. Every thought captive. And we must never allow ourselves to become complacent or to allow ourselves to become stagnant in spirit, but to press on diligently in every way that we can, every opportunity that's open to us. Whom will you serve? I know that there will be many here, and I take comfort in that, that will continue to serve Him. But if you are here and have suffered with and struggled with complacency and stagnation, now would be a good time to bury that. If you're a child of God, to come back and allow us to pray for you and with you and for all of us, that we'd be a zealous and vigorous people. If you're here not in Christ, there's no greater need than anyone has. We'll all leave this world. We know that. But whether we leave it and go to be with the Lord or not, it's contingent upon the spirit that we manifest here. If you are a person who believes that Jesus of Nazareth is the Son of the very God, repent and turn away from sin if you've not done that. Renounce it. And come confess your faith before our Lord, because He requires that. He said, whosoever therefore shall confess me before men, him will I also confess before my Father who is in heaven. And whosoever shall deny me before men, him will I also deny before my Father who is in heaven. That's Matthew 10, 32 and 33. And as a confessing believer, consent to be buried with the Lord in baptism for the remission of sins. Rise up to walk in the new life. Don't allow stagnation or distraction from the present world to deter you. Just march right on through the gate. We sang about it a while ago. And now we have a song that's designed to encourage people to come. And if you would, come now. As together we're standing and singing.
Hear the sweet voice of Jesus say, come to me, I am the way. Hearken the love, all obey. Come for He loves. For you. Jesus the Crucified.
Please be seated. Number 645. 645.
On a hill far away stood an old rugged cross, the emblem of suffering and shame. And I love that old cross where the dearest and best for a world of lost sinners was slain. So I'll cherish the hope of it grows till my trophy at last I lay down. I will someday for the crown. Oh, that old rugged cross, so despised by the world, has a wondrous attraction for me. For the dear Lamb of God left his glory to bear it to Calvary. So cherish the hope of it glorious till my trophy's at last I lay down. I will cling to someday for the crown. To that old rugged cross I will ever be true. It shamed me most gladly there. Then you call me someday to my home for at last I lay down. I proclaim to your rugged cross, and exchange it someday for a crown.
This is a solemn occasion. It's no time to be stagnant or complacent. We read of a time in the Old Testament where God's people became stagnant and complacent. And they were carrying what God had deemed as holy in a manner that He didn't authorize. And a young man reached up and put his hand on the Ark of the Covenant and was struck dead. And it's not an accident that it was called the Ark of the Covenant. In Luke, it tells us that Christ took the bread and He broke it and He blessed it and said, "Do this in remembrance of me." And then He took the cup and He blessed it and He said, "This is my blood of the new covenant." And Paul told us in Corinthians that we're not to partake in an unworthy manner. That if we do, if we examine ourselves and we partake in an unworthy manner, we're eating and drinking damnation to our souls. God tells us what He wants and how He wants it. And let's truly do this in remembrance. Would you pray with me? Our Holy Father, we are so thankful for your blessings, and we know we're truly blessed. And Father, as we remember that sacrifice, and we partake of this bread which is to us Christ's body, help us to do it in a worthy manner, and help us to remember that sacrifice every day, and not to be stagnant or complacent. In Christ Jesus' name, amen. Our Father in heaven, as we continue our prayer unto you and then continue this memorial service, help us to remember and understand that we've been bought with blood. And as we partake of this cup which is to us Christ's blood of the new covenant, help us to do it in a worthy manner. And Father, help us to be truly thankful. In Jesus' name, amen. Ordinarily at this time, because of convenience, we offer a prayer and pass the collection plate. But there is a box provided at the back on the table that you can put your contribution in as you leave. If you would, we'll pray for that contribution now. Our Holy Father, help us to understand that all good and perfect gifts come from you. That everything that we have is because of you. And Father, as we return a portion of those blessings back to you, help us to do it cheerfully and willingly. Father, help it to be something that we purposed in our hearts. For Father, we know that our hearts are what count. We ask that you bless these contributions and bless our elders as they decide how to use them. Help them to be used for the best advantage for the cause of Christ here and in all those places that we support. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
I want to take the opportunity to thank you, number one, for being here today and to encourage everyone to be back Wednesday night if you can for Bible study. As long as we are able to stay healthy, we're going to try to do that. We thank you and urge you to continue to observe the protocols that the health authorities are giving to us. Because if we all stay healthy, then of course that's going to enable us to continue to meet in this way. We want to be good citizens in the community, as we've stressed. I think it bears stressing some too that if you are sick and have the symptoms of the current virus, that think about other people and don't get out among them until you know. Just don't take a chance with it. As you know, in our fellowship, we have a number of people that are at high risk. So we just want to try to protect them. And we urge you to continue to help us. Thank all of those that participated today. You've done well, and we'll pray that God will be pleased with our efforts. Now we'll be dismissed with a word of prayer as we're standing together. Would you bow?
Shall we pray? Father in heaven, as we come to the close of this hour, it is our prayer that the things that were said and done in this here this morning were totally in accordance to thy will. We ask you, Father, to take us safely home, bring us back at the next appointed time this Wednesday night. Let us, each and every one of us, continue to develop the talents that we have to let our light shine for you. Guide us in thy service and forgive us of our sins, for this is our prayer in Christ's name. Amen.